The Himalayas stretch 1,500 miles across Asia. They're home to 14 of the tallest mountains on the planet. And one rises above all others, Everest. At 5.5 miles tall, Everest is the highest mountain in the world. In order to figure out how this giant mountain was made, geologists need evidence. Rock samples from Everest. It's a dangerous mission, and only a few people are willing to undertake it. Kenton Cool is one of the world's best high-altitude climbers, and he will embark on this geological mission to the summit of Everest. His instructions from geologists are to collect rock samples from three places. One from the summit, and two from lower down. These incredibly rare samples will give investigators crucial evidence. Kenton is at Everest Base Camp. Pitched on jagged rocks at 17,500 feet, this camp is over 3 miles above sea level.
Sorting out the last of the items I need to take on a summit push. And I've just been to collect a load of Ziploc bags, which I hope to put all the samples in.
Over the next 5 days, he will climb 12,000 feet, the equivalent vertical height of 8 Empire State Buildings. Kenton starts his mission from base camp. He negotiates the Khumbu Icefall, a frozen river with crevasses thousands of feet deep. It's a treacherous ascent, as all this glacial ice is constantly moving, and looming ice towers threaten to collapse. Kenton now has the most dangerous section ahead of him. At 21,000 feet, he is already higher than Mount McKinley. He has a sheer ice climb up the side of Everest. Winds reach speeds in excess of 100 miles an hour, and temperatures drop to minus 40 degrees. Since leaving base camp, Kenton has climbed for 4 days. At 26,000 feet, he reaches the point which joins Everest and its neighboring mountain, Lhotse.
So here we are, this is the South Col, one of the highest camps in the world, 7,950 meters. So high that nothing can actually live here.
From this camp, Kenton will leave at 3 a.m., climb through the night, and aim to arrive at the summit in the morning.
Pitch black, that's 3 in the morning.
Timing is crucial, and the weather must be ideal. The window for ascent is narrow. There are only around 12 days of the year when climbers can make it to the summit. Kenton must take this opportunity. He now ventures into what climbers call the death zone. Oxygen is needed to make the climb, as the air is 3 times thinner than at sea level. 1 in 10 people die climbing Everest. And most fatalities occur during this final stage.
One more.
Kenton finally reaches the top of Everest.
8,850 meters. We are the highest people in the world.
This is the view from the highest place on planet Earth. For most climbers, the summit is the ultimate goal. But for Kenton, his mission has only just begun. He heads just below the summit to find an exposed outcrop of rock. Kenton's first sample is a gray limestone. It's soft and easy to break off. This is a sample of the highest rock in the world. One down, two to go. Kenton descends further to collect the next sample. Just below the summit, the rock changes. Climbers call it the yellow band due to its distinctive color. The rock is dramatically different from the summit. Much harder and yellow in color. This is a layer of marble.
All right, there we go. This is off the yellow band. All right, so that's that. That's the yellow band. We've collected samples from here. It's not been very easy. We're getting out of here. It's beginning to snow.
But he has one more to go. Kenton starts the long descent to where he'll get the next piece of evidence. He enters into the Western Coombe, a huge U-shaped valley which has been carved by the Khumbu Glacier, a frozen river of ice that has relentlessly pushed downward over the past million years. Rock and debris in the glacier have ground away at the rock underneath, revealing the base of Everest. Kenton needs to take his final sample from this area of distinctive white rock, granite.
So here we are in the Western Coombe on Everest, about 6,400 meters. I've actually stood underneath one of the easier outcrops to get to. This is a big sort of granite cliff above me.
This white rock is full of crystals. It's extremely hard and different again from the summit limestone and the marble.
Yeah, we've got quite a nice sample of the granite there.
With the three precious samples safely packed away, Kenton takes them to the University of Oxford. Here they will be analyzed by the world's leading authority on Everest, Mike Searle.
So Mike, this is your summit rock. Now, that is from the top of the world.
Well, this sample, Kenton, is probably one of the most important samples of the whole expedition. So it's literally worth its weight in gold geologically. This came from the summit of Everest right there. The next rock down that you collected was from the yellow band. And even further down is another rock, a granite.
Almost a complete picture of Everest.
That's right, yes.
Fantastic. Yeah.
These three rocks are the major components which make up Everest.
All that effort to get up to the summit was, I can tell you, was absolutely worth it.
Good.
To get this sample.
Good, good, I hope so.
So the next step is we want to find out what's in it.
The summit rock is cut into a thin section. So thin, light can pass through it.
Okay, let's have a look at this slide of a limestone that's from the summit of Everest.
The highest rock sample in the world reveals its secret.
Oh, that looks interesting. What's that? We've got a section here through a crinoid stem. A crinoid is a sea lily.
From fossil records, the section can be dated. It is over 400 million years old. The sea lily is evidence that the summit rock of Everest was formed in an ancient marine environment.
So from seeing this evidence, we can categorically say that this rock would have started life at the bottom of the seafloor. And then I've collected it from the very, very top of the world, from the summit of Everest itself. That's just amazing.